Today's video is about a game. You start off with a deck of playing cards that you actually, instead of shuffling it normally, you flip half of it over every time you shuffle, so that some of the cards are going to wind up face up and some of them are going to wind up face down.
You're a good shuffler.
Thank you. I actually have to do it a bunch of times because I truly want it to be randomized if it's face up or face down. So I don't want it exactly 50-50. I want them to be up or down as they may. Then you pick a number, and we're going to do it first with a small number. So give me a number between, say, 5 and 10.
Let's go for 6.
6. So you lay out 6 cards in a row with the edges touching each other. The objective of the game is to wipe the table of all the cards. And the way the game is played is you can draw out a card only when it's face up. So right now I've got 3 choices for which card I could start by drawing out. And the second rule is that when you draw the card, if it's still touching either of its neighbors, you flip over any of its remaining neighbors. So anything that's still touching it gets flipped over.
How do you choose your first card?
Well, it's kind of like solitaire. You want to strategize so that you win the game. If you choose the wrong card, it's possible to mess the whole thing up and wind up losing. Say I choose this card right here. So I draw it out, flip over both of its neighbors. But now this little island right here is actually stuck. No chance of either of these cards getting flipped over. I can't pull them out. I'm going to lose the game. If you're going to play the game to win, you want to strategize a bit. And then let's say we start off with this queen. And we draw her out. And flip over the 2 neighbors. This is isolated, but we can draw this one out. And then let's go ahead and draw this end, flip over this 2, then draw this jack, flip over his neighbors, and then we can draw out each of these remaining 2 cards. And
you did it. You won.
Now I'm going to deal out another 6 cards and see if we can win a second game. All right, now I can tell you right now, this game is not winnable. Even if I played with optimum strategy, nothing will work. If I try to remove this king, then it would flip over these 2 cards, and I can already see I've made a mistake because this island over here is never going to be able to be removed. So let me undo that. If I tried, say, this 10 instead, then I am going to be able to remove this last card in the island. Now, if I remove this club, I can remove the king, but whichever of these 2 cards I remove, if I remove the 2, flip over this jack. If I remove the jack, you'll flip over this 2. And stuck forever. Trust me, you can't win this one. So if you're playing this game and you can choose any number of cards to play with, what's the probability that you wind up with a game that's impossible no matter how well you play? I've seen 3 different beautiful proofs of this. 2 of them are very formal. 2 of them are the kinds of proof that if you're familiar with an inductive strategy proof or breaking down a large game into smaller parts, you can do fairly like formal proofs that way. But I'm going to show you a proof that is based on jigsaw puzzle pieces instead. One that it was the first proof I ever wrote. And I have some, I guess, nostalgia for it because of that. So, spoiler, if you play this game a million times, you'll find that approximately half of those times you'll be able to win it, playing perfectly. And half the times you'll have laid out a scenario that's impossible to ever win.
Can you tell by looking at it?
I can. I can tell just by scanning across the cards once.
What are you looking for? What are you looking at to give it away? Or are you not telling me?
You're looking specifically at the number of face-up cards, and you're looking to see if there's an even number of them or an odd number of them total. And if there are an even number of them, then you're very sad. Or you say, ah, deal again. If they're an odd number, you give it the green light and you try to play it. Let's try a slightly larger game this time. Can you pick a number between 10 and 20?
Let's go 13.
13. All right, 13 cards.
So there's 5.
Because there are an odd number of face-up cards. If you play this perfectly, you'll be able to win.
Prove it.
Excellent. So I'm actually going to do more than just prove that this game is winnable. I could do that just by playing it and showing you that I could win. Instead, I'm going to show you a way to prove that for any odd number of face-up cards, you can win that game. I could start with this card right here. And that would flip both of its neighbors, then this card, then that would flip this one over, so that could be my third, fourth, fourth. Let's say I go down here for the fifth. And here, something that I really love is going to happen. If you draw this card, you wind up with what I think of as a fuse going down to the left. It just kind of burns down that streak. And it could also burn off to the right. So this is five, and go ahead and call this six, seven, eight. Then this card right here next, and I'll burn down this streak, 10, 11, 12, 13. So I can remove this in this order and just show, and you can like move my hands super fast. One.
Done it.
Yes. Well, success. Played.
All right, cool. Let's reload it.
Now let's look at the proof for why any odd number of face-up cards can be one. So if you look at this particular sequence, you can see that it follows two rules that match the rules of the game. Mainly that if I've got a face-up card, then I can draw it out before either of its neighbors, or I can draw it out after both of its neighbors. But if I've drawn out one of its neighbors and not the other, it'll be flipped over and it's stuck. So five is less than both 10 and six because of this. If a card is face down, then it's stuck initially. But if I draw one of its two neighbors, either one, in this case, this card gets drawn out first, it'll flip over and I'll be able to draw it out as long as I don't also draw out the card to the other side of it. So it has to be before one of its neighbors and after the other. So face-up cards are either going to have to be less than both of the neighbors or greater than both of the neighbors. So this one, this one, is less than both. This four is greater than both. Now this three, this face-down three, it has to be greater than one neighbor and less than the other, so that it's been flipped over exactly once and we can draw it out. This three is greater than two. And at the end here, nothing to the right of that. So this card, because it's face up, it absolutely has to be drawn out before its neighbor. If this card were drawn out first, this would be stuck forever. And on this side, 10 is less than 11, which is less than 12, which is less than 13. And right here in the center, six is less than seven, which is less than eight. So I played a bunch of games when I was trying to figure out how to prove this. Then I looked at this sort of greater than less than sequence, and it started to look a lot like a jigsaw puzzle to me. And I realized that all of the face up cards looked like one of two kinds of pieces. They either looked like these sort of diamond shaped pieces, or they looked like these kind of concave pieces. This one here in the center connecting the nine and the four piece. And then for all of the face down cards, every single piece looks exactly the same. Double to the left or double to the right. So I just made one kind for that and started putting them in, either moving to the right or moving to the left. And then the two ends are something special. The two ends are completely forced based on if it's face up or face down. If it's face down, then it absolutely has to be drawn after its neighbor because it's stuck to begin with. So greater than makes the piece look like this. On the other hand, if it's face up, then it absolutely has to be drawn before its neighbor. If I drew out this card first, this one, we get stuck. So I better have drawn that out before the card next to it. So I created these two pieces for the possibilities of the ends.
All right.
All right. So again, we've drawn out one that has five face-up cards, so this is going to be solvable, but have no clue what order will work. And I'm gonna show you how to use the pieces to both see that it's solvable and see what ordering will work. So starting from the left, because this card is face up, it has to be drawn out earlier, so with an order that's less than its neighbor. And this card being face up means that I have a choice, either after both of its neighbors or before. So this is after, or there is a number on this card is greater than both of its neighbors, and this one would be before both of its neighbors. And I'm choosing between these, but only one of them agrees with the card to the left of it. So the choice is actually completely forced. I have to put down this one. So then moving on, this one's face down. That means it has to be earlier than one neighbor and less than the other, but we already know that it's going to be earlier than this one, which means it has to be earlier and then less than its right neighbor. I'm just going to keep going down. And for every face down card, this is the shape that it has to be. It's either going to be to the left or to the right, but it's always going to be forced by what came before it. For face up cards, have to put down the one that fits next to the blue piece just laid.
So let's fill it up.
All right. Now it's the moment of truth. We've got one card at the end and two possible pieces. For this face down card though, it has to be drawn out after its neighbor. No choice there. So we'd better hope that its number, that the number of its order, we'd better hope that the order is larger than the card next to it. In this case, it can be. This sign right here saying that this number can be larger than this number. Therefore, this is the piece that fits. That's good. The green pieces are the ones that go with a face down card on the edge.
So it accepts, well, luckily it accepts it, it's receiving it. Yeah.
Exactly. And if it had happened to be a face up card here on the edge, meaning that there are six total face up cards, this wouldn't have worked. This would have had to be drawn out before its neighbor, it would have been stuck there forever, meaning that it would need this piece under it, but this piece doesn't fit. So we're very happy that we've got a face down card on the edge.
All right.
We actually can actually use this to see how to win the game. In particular, we can see that the cards that need to be drawn out early are the cards that have the smallest values. Those are going to be the yellow cards. You can draw those out in either order. You can do this whole side of the game before this side of the game, but this card has to be drawn out before both of its neighbors. And in fact, any sequence of removing the cards that follows these rules for which parts of the order are earlier or later is going to be a winning way to play this game.
How do you know that you can't deal out an even number of face-ups and still make a jigsaw that works?
I'm very glad you asked that question. That is the question of the day. To help answer the question, let me introduce you to my hedgehog.
Oh, what's his name?
You want me to name him? Calvin the Hedgehog. Calvin the Hedgehog is a bit fussy. In particular, he likes to go on walks, but whenever he reaches an arrow, he has to go over it in a way that's aligned with his nose. So if he's reaching an arrow that points to the left, he actually is going to turn around and start going backwards until he reaches an arrow that faces to the right again. He's going to switch it and keep going.
He can get to the end bottom first. He just has to get to the end.
Yes, he can get to the end butt first. Bottom. He can get to the end bottom first, but he has to reach all the way from the left side to the right side. And he's incredibly fussy, so if he ever has to break the rules, he's not willing to proceed. So you asked me why an even number of face-up cards wouldn't work. And the answer is, if you imagine Calvin starting at the beginning and going over the cards, every time there's a face-up card, including at the very beginning, it causes Calvin to turn. Now, at the end here, we can actually figure out which direction he's facing just by looking at how many face-up cards there were, because those are the only points when he turned. And if he's turned around a even number of times, so if he starts off going ahead and then turns one, two, he's back to forward, three, four, back to forward. So if he turns an even number of times, if there are an even number of face-up cards, then he's going to be going the same direction as he started. If he starts on a picture card, then he has to start off pointing to the left, so walking butt first. And then every time he reaches a face-up card, he'll turn around. This means that if there are an even number of face-up cards after this first one, which means an odd number total, he'll wind up facing backwards at the very end. And if he's facing backwards at the very end, then the last card absolutely has to be one that fits in with this arrow, an arrow pointing left, meaning that it absolutely has to be a face-down card. So in total, you'll have an odd number of face-up cards. If at the beginning your first card is face down, well, that changes the entire puzzle sequence all the way across. You'll have a hedgehog that gets to start going forward. And then if it passes over an odd number of face-up cards, it will have turned around backwards. If it passes over an even number of face-up cards, it will have turned around so that it's backwards, forwards, backwards, turned around until it's facing ultimately forwards again. So replacing this card here with a reverse every single piece in the row. Every red block would become yellow, and every blue block would have to change directions. And by the time you get to the end, you'd need the opposite kind of card in order to complete it. So ultimately, if this one winds up face up, end has to be down. This one down, end up. That's based on the number in the middle. If the number in the middle is odd, then the ends have to match. If the number in the middle is even, then the ends have to be different.
Do you ever play this game anymore, or is playing this game boring because you always know the result now?
I like to play this game with people who have never played it before, because if you give them a long sequence of cards, even though it might be possible to win it, and you might know how, if there are an odd number of face-up cards in the middle, if they pick the wrong ones in the wrong order, then they can still lose the game. And so there's still some strategy involved, and that moment where you realize, oh, they just flipped over that card and I know they're doomed. They don't see it yet, but I know they're doomed. And I guess I like that moment. All right, I'm gonna ask you to pick a number between 10 and 20, and you're gonna say 13.
All right, go on then.
All right, now let's try playing a longer game. Pick a number between 10 and 20 this time.
14.
All right. All right.